they had this kind of an ethics, conservation ethics, ingrained in their life. So they had unwritten rules that there'll be a ban on hunting of animals during breeding season. So whenever there is a breeding season going on, people avoid killing the animals or the fish also, because that is a very important period when the progeny of that particular species is born and gets established. And that is important for conservation. Then avoid killing pregnant animals. So if there is a herd of animals somewhere, they deliberately avoided the pregnant ones. Avoid killing fawns, that means the younger animals. That we must understand is that their hunting was for livelihood and not for pleasure, which this pleasure part was introduced by us, the civilized world. And how it was introduced, we'll come to that. In totality, you must say that they tried to keep the resource base enough for sustaining the not only the resource base, but also their own livelihood system. Our laws did not differentiate between hunting for livelihood and hunting for pleasure. Second thing, what was thought was that we just close the area and things will improve. That is the best management option. That is not the best management tool. There we have erred. Then even technologies, the knowledge base, indigenous knowledge, all those things took a back seat. It's a very different kind of a topic, and I, being a forester, I have been quite a lot associated with the tribals, tribal areas, and also forest areas. If you superimpose the map of tribal population and the forest areas, you will find that they almost overlap. So from that point of view, we have been interacting with so many tribes. Out of them, this is a tribe which I found very interesting, but having a very sad kind of a story. And so I'll be basically telling you a story in two, three formats, so far as the Pardhis are concerned. One is their a bit of their anthropological part, then their occupational part, and then how they were forced to become almost ecological refugees because of the fact that we overexploited the resource base on which their livelihood was dependent. And that was done by us, the civilized society, so to say. Pardhis, they have a very interesting kind of origin, so to say, because different anthropologists and other social science people, they have studied them. And the Pardhis also have their own story to tell about their origin. And many of them say that since the Pardh is a Sanskrit word and it means hunting, so they say that traditionally it has been given as a variant of Pardh. Those who practice Pardh is Pardhi. And they were found primarily in the state of Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh. But gradually you will find that they are found all over India, you know, because their primary occupation and occupational base has been disturbed. And they have been wanderers, basically. They have not been having a particular village or something, which many of the tribes have. So, and some of them, they say that they are the descendants of Pardhi Mahadev, jinhone ki Arjuna ko challenge kiya tha in hunting. So they also associate themselves with Pardhi Mahadev. Some studies have shown that they are sort of flow from Rana Rajputs. And these were those people who had not sided with Maharana Pratap and went and sided with Akbar. And after that, they were actually hunted out from that area, and they fled from Rajasthan to Gujarat and then to to Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh, all these areas. So that is how they initially spread. Some studies also show that they have originated from mixing of Rajputs with Bawari people who are outcasts and social derelicts, basically. And some police studies, they have shown them to be originating from a tribe called Bawriya tribe, which is considered as one of the main criminal tribes in the list of British documents. There have been good studies by Maharashtra scholars in the Gyan Kosh also, it is mentioned, then Bharatiya Sanskriti Gyan Kosh by Joshi Saab and Maharashtra Vishwakosh by Lakshman Shastri Joshi Ji. So they have been a subject of study, but the study from the point of view of their occupational situation and the degradation and their movement towards becoming almost very poor people without any resources and wandering from here and there, so to say, ecological refugees. That kind of a study was not done earlier. I tried to see it from this point of view. So, and they are often in news, you might have read, they are also associated with crimes. In fact, the police department, whenever there is a crime in those areas where Pardis are there, they will first go and catch the Pardi guy and declare in the newspaper next day that the criminals are caught. So that also is a strategy with the enforcement people, you know. That's another unfortunate part of it. And it has a tradition which I'll further narrate. This is a very interesting thing that the Pardhi, it was a group earlier, but with time and with areas that they came to, they specialized into various kinds of occupation. And therefore, these Pardhis became 11 types of Pardhis, in fact. And that is dependent on the occupational characteristic of these Pardis. Most commonly known are Phase Pardis, who hunt with snares and traps, and Shikari or Bheel Pardi. Bheel Pardis use firearms. Then Langoti Pardi is there, who is actually said to be engaged in dacoity or burglary. And they wear just the loincloth so that they are not easily caught, you know. So that's a strategy. Then Cheeta Pardhi or Cheeta Wale Pardhi, who used to tame leopards, cheetahs rather, or leopards also are called in some of these documents, and hunted the deer and other small animals. Then Haran Pardhi, who used to hunt using antelopes and deer, and they used to send these antelopes and deer into the herds. And then gradually they used to catch those animals. Then Bahelia is basically for those who hunt birds. And there is a variety of this called Karijat. And they are found mostly in Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh areas. And they kill birds only of black color. That is something very special about them. Then Gosai Pardi is there in Madhya Pradesh. They will not kill deer, but would kill foxes, hares, jackals, traditionally, yes. Then there is another Takankar Pardhi, whom you might have seen on the roadside, you know, they are roughening the household grinding mills. And the police records say that they have strong criminal tendencies, just like Langoti Pardhis. I mean, that is what is the police department's police studies view. Then there are Gaike Pardis. They stalk their prey behind bullocks and hunt. Then there are Bandarwales. They exhibit monkeys performance. And then even from medicinal point of view, you can say traditional medicinal point of view, the oil and other things that come out of the animals, you know, they are being used by these people. And they are also called Shishi Ke Telwale or Tel Vechnya Pardis. So, Ashar Prakar Se, Akra Prakar Se Pardhi Zaye, Sadhya, on record. The population till 2001, you will find that the recorded population was only 30,000. And they were found here and there in small groups, small sort of hamlets. And that also used to be shifting. Later on, what happened is that the census records that is that adopts a particular classification called classification 3. And therein, all these Pardhis got included as a group of, along with the group of people who were related to livestock, forestry, hunting, plantations, allied activities, etc. So as of now, very clear determination of exact number of these 11 Pardhis, types of Pardhis, is not really available. That's unfortunate. Now, the aspect of criminality that was associated with Pardhi, this is a very interesting story, but a very unfortunate one. You see, in 1871, and prior to 1871, actually, in 1856, there was a circular which said that certain tribes were declared as criminal tribes. And they were, most of the cases were where they were fighting the British. And therefore, they were branded as criminals. Later on, an act came in 1871, and that accorded legal authority to the actions that could be taken through the 1856 circular. So from circular, it became an act, which is actually a leap forward in terms of branding these people as criminal tribes. Then later in 1893, they started getting dealt with the regulation 26, which was again basically related to handling the criminal people. And later on in 1897, Criminal Tribes Act was passed by the British. The police commission also studied their criminality. There was a study done. And they said that the results were quite varied from one province to another. I mean, in different areas, they behaved differently. And maybe depending on the social structure that was there, or maybe dependent on the kind of occupation they had been into. But they also said that for improving these people, they made a remark that too much had been left to the fortuitous enthusiasm of individual officers. There were individual officers who wanted that these criminal tribes, so-called criminal tribes, should be brought out of that branding and they should be developed. But the government was not that happy with many of such actions, and they wanted to curtail the authority of the individual officer to take initiatives, etc. That was British government. In 1991, there was a police commission report, and it basically suggested three main things. One was that there must be strict and effective control over the worst tribes. These were the worst tribes for them. And then individuals who behaved, who exhibited good conduct, were exempted. And education was to be provided to the children. This was 1911. But all these got further consolidated in the Central Act of 1924. So you see that these people were handled by the police department, or from the police angle, as a criminal group of people. And this 1924 was a very strong act. In fact, it authorized provincial governments to declare tribal or any class of person to be a criminal tribe. So you can just imagine when India was under the British, and obviously anybody talking against the British government was supposed to be a criminal guy. And those people must be strongly against the kind of dominance of these British people, and must be exploited also by the British people, because these were available in plenty in many areas. They were because they were moving around, and they were also helping British people, British officers in hunting. Now, the member of the tribes had to register themselves. That was another point. They were asked to give their fingerprints, and they had to notify the place of residence. The provincial government, however, there was some angle to it, which we could say that, yes, there was an attempt to improve their situation. So they could establish industrial, agricultural settlements or reformatory settlements also. And the provincial government could direct that the children of these Pardhis could be kept away from them for the purpose of education. So, and in case, yes, this was also there, that in case a member of this tribal community did something wrong or did some crime, then they were subjected to an enhanced punishment. So Pardhis, gradually, you must have noticed that they were gradually consolidated in terms of perception about them as a real criminal tribe. And this actually persists today also, unfortunately. Although after independence, we had the Criminal Tribes Law Repeal Act in 1952, which denotified them. And then the fifth schedule of the Constitution started giving specific directions. Under that was given to provide for administration and control of the scheduled areas and scheduled tribes, etc. But one thing that really took me by shock, but not surprise, in fact, because the ICS retired officer, he writes that when after the denotification was done, he has written in his book that it is perhaps unfortunate that false consideration of national prestige and a misinterpretation of the meaning of democracy led to the repeal of Criminal Tribes Act shortly after India became independent. You see the strong feeling that they had about such people being branded and considered as a criminal tribe, which is so unfortunate. And that branding, you know, that branding has really done a lot of harm to them, which we will talk about in future slides. Now, let us come to their occupational part. The first one part was how they were seen by the administration and the police. And now, how they saw and managed themselves, you know, in their day-to-day life, in their occupational behavior. They had this kind of an ethics, conservation ethics, ingrained in their life. So they had unwritten rules that there'll be a ban on hunting of animals during breeding season. Even fishing, you must be knowing that during the month of Shravan and all, people are advised not to fish. So whenever there is a breeding season going on, people avoid killing the animals or the fish also, because that is a very important period when the progeny of that particular species is born and gets established. And that is important for conservation. Then avoid killing pregnant animals. So if there is a herd of animals somewhere, they deliberately avoided the pregnant ones. Avoid killing fawns, that means the younger animals. So they were very selective in catching the animals or killing the animals. So selective killing of animals was practiced by them. And obviously this was their occupation. This was food for them, not only for them, but for the whole village folk, because they were, I must say, they were the suppliers of protein to the village people. Similarly, they had the rule of catching or killing crocodiles for fat and oil. So there were specific months that were prescribed. And their basic thing, you know, that we must understand is that their hunting was for livelihood and not for pleasure. Which this pleasure part was introduced by us, the civilized world. And how it was introduced, we'll come to that. Another discipline they had that they always hunted on foot. And therefore, in totality, you must say that they tried to keep the resource base enough for sustaining the not only the resource base, but also their own livelihood system. And interestingly, the wildlife-related legislations that India started had components of this as a part of the sections, as a part of the provisions. Except 6 and 7 and 8, which I have mentioned here, all others were a part of the initial wildlife acts in our country. And you'll be happy to know that the Bombay Wild Animals and Wild Bird Protection Act 1951 was the first of its kind in the country. And there also specific issues related to hunting were mentioned to control hunting, to have conservation. You see the, anyway, I'll come to that Wildlife Protection Act later. Then in 1954, firstly, regulations also were there in Marathwada areas. They also had control systems like this. Next step India took was 1972, we had the Wildlife Protection Act. Now, this was called the Protection Act. But interestingly, you will find that it had components of conservation, in fact. And conservation by fundamental understanding, you know, the definition per se means not just protection, but also consumption. So conservation is protection plus consumption. And now we have entered into sustainable utilization level. So gradually the concepts have been coming up like this. Then in 1991, the Wildlife Protection Act was amended. And there was a total ban on hunting of all wildlife animals. So you see that initially we started with regulation. Then finally we banned all the wild animal hunting. And in 2003, we also started to put in some community and conservation reserves for conservation. But they are not that focused on the wildlife in that area per se. Most of them are corridors between different protected areas, that is the national parks and sanctuaries. So this is the road that the wildlife related acts started in India. But the fact remained that the resources degraded over time. The resources on which the Pardhis were dependent for their livelihood, they degraded over time. The Mughals and Zamindars, they were also hunting in a big way. You must have seen some of the old photographs where they are very proudly standing on the carcass of a tiger or a lion or an elephant with their guns and showing that they have done a big job. So that was the tradition. That was the kind of valor that was being said to be very great that time. But that also led to a lot of degradation of the animals. Huge hunting processions were there. Khedas were there for elephants. Even during Akbar's time, they say that cheetahs were deployed for hunting. And huge number of animals were hunted by not people who hunted for livelihoods, but by those people who hunted for pleasure. And that kind of a transition has been the most unfortunate part in conservation history. Then the government of India in the British times, they started incentive schemes for killing the animals. The population was growing, and therefore they wanted all the forest areas to be cut and converted into agriculture and all those things. And there was, wherever there was a habitation being developed or set up, there were incentive schemes started by the British government for killing the animals. That was another aspect of resource degradation. This is just an example. Reward amounts, you can just say that that time, 1875 and odd, full-grown tiger, if you had killed, you get rupees 24. Half-grown 12, cubs 6. This, imagine the kind of change in or difference in the perception. These Pardhis, they said, no, the fawn should not be killed. The younger animals should not be killed. And here, for killing the cubs, they were being rewarded. Similarly, for killing cheetahs, leopards, panthers, bear, full-grown 12, half-grown 6 rupees. That time, imagine the amount of the value of rupees 6. Then even cubs were of these, if they were killed and brought before the assistant collector, so that time, they were paid rupees 3. Full-grown wolves were also, once killed in Khandesh and Ahmednagar, they were given rupees 4. So apart from the fact that there was huge pressure on the existing wildlife or the resource base for the Pardhis, these were some other areas where their resource base was very specifically and very in a planned way getting removed from the areas where they were existing. Later on, the rewards for tiger, cheetah, leopard, panthers, deer, and full-grown wolves in Ahmednagar and Khandesh were abolished. Maybe some good sense prevailed upon the concerned collector maybe that time in 1917. In Ratnagiri and Satara district, our own Maharashtra areas, the snake killing was also recognized. Occupation and rewards were paid for that. So for killing cobras or other species having a fang, they were paid 2 annas or 6 paisa. And imagine the impact of these killings, if they are huge killings, the impact of these killings on the agriculture, on the wildlife diversity, that is immense. I'll just give an example of frogs, During around 1990s, we were exporting frog legs from India. And in huge containers, they used to go. For about 3-4 years, it continued as a huge profiting business for many people, and government used to permit export of frog legs. And biggest export was being done from Mumbai port. The impact was that all the areas having agricultural produce in the Western Ghats and this part of Maharashtra, this side, nearer to Mumbai, the production went down. Agricultural production went down. That was a study done. And then it was found that because the frogs were removed from there, so the impact of insects and other things were so much on the crop that the production had gone down. And then there was a ban on the export of frog legs. So we may think that, yes, it's a very small thing, frogs we are catching only during one season and say sending it, and we are getting so much of money, good amount of foreign exchange we are earning, but the impacts are tremendous, and the impacts are unfortunately not on the people who are so-called civilized and urban. It impacts the rural people, impacts the really people who don't deserve that kind of a negative impact. That was just an example. And therefore, it's interesting to note that in the reward systems also, there were frauds at that time. So people used to claim twice for the same snake, etc., etc. So there were circulars which said that the captured snake should be cut into pieces in front of the officer. And then the and similarly, I mean, you had to take the ears of the animal before the collector or the additional collector to get your reward, all those things. So there was a control system also in the reward system, but a reward was there. Now, in the first act that we had, what we did was that there were certain hunting methods which were declared as unlawful. One was using wheeled or mechanically propelled vehicle, using motor car, etc., for hunting or stampeding. Then hunting with nets, snares, pitfalls, etc., etc. There were a number of types of hunting processes mentioned, and they were all made illegal. Setting fire for hunting, using artificial light. Earlier, those who are of my age may be remembering that we used to go with spotlights in the night and move into the forest to see the animals. Now, even that is banned. You can't use the spotlight in the night. At that time, spotting animal in the night was allowed, but killing was not allowed. Then hunting during night hours was not allowed. Hunting on a salt lick or water hole was not allowed. You see, salt licks are the places where the government puts salt. There are certain places where salt is put so as to let the animals sort of meet the requirement of the salts, you know. And they are very happy with the salt lick, and it also becomes a very good place for sighting the animals. And waterhole, of course. Hunting on land in private ownership was also not permitted without consent of the owner. And there were closed times that they were declared that during this will be a closed time when there will be no hunting in the forest. So these were the regulations brought in. And the license Raj came in. With this, the shikar required a license. And once the license Raj came in, obviously it favored VIPs, government servants, and those people who would go to the office of the Deputy Conservator of Forest or DFO that time, or the Conservator of Forest, and get a license. And here, this Pardhi, nobody can even imagine that one Pardhi could have been so bold that he would go to a particular office, government office, and ask for a license and get it. So you see, the license Raj also had its own impact on the Pardhis, so far as their livelihood was concerned. Since they could not get the license, they didn't have the wherewithal to have the license, and therefore whatever they did most of the time was seen as illegal by the forest department, and they were caught. Now, the Wildlife Protection Act 72, as I told you, that its name is protection, but it was actually conservation. Had it been very strictly implemented — implementation is a big question mark in most of the acts in our country, unfortunately. So this act basically distributed the wild animals into different schedules and applied controls for those scheduled animals. And the names of the schedule, the headings of the schedule that time were special game, big game, small game, vermin. Special game were those like tigers, etc., etc. But they were scheduled one protected species also, which could be hunted, but with permissions, of course. And we'll come to that. Then the provision for granting license was, of course, there. Now, wildlife as a game, you know, seeing it as a game, there are people who say that this is exploitative name. But in natural resources arena, you have to use it or lose it. That is one very basic concept. Because ultimately, we are also, as human beings, the whole society, the whole economy, goes by the thinking that it should earn something for the society or for the economy or for the country. And therefore, you have to use a particular resource. And if you don't use it, you lose it. Here, what we did was that, yes, in the big game, special game, etc., etc., since there were provisions, control systems were there. I mean, in whatever way it was implemented, that is another question. But there was a possibility of taking out the resource from that area and allowing the new sort of populations to grow. And there could be management processes that could be deployed there. So that was in 1972, the basic theme. That we will also remove the wildlife from there and also allow it to regenerate, protect. But in 1991, we made an amendment and all the hunting was banned. So this, in one stroke, basically criminalized the occupation of the Pardis straight away. Exceptions were there, even still it is there, and they say that only when wildlife is dangerous to human life or is disabled or disease beyond recovery or it is required for education, scientific research or management purposes, then only it can be allowed to be hunted, not otherwise. And the word hunting is very interesting in this act. We normally think that hunting means killing. But even disturbing the egg of a bird in a nest is also hunting. Disturbing the nest is hunting. Following an animal, a wild animal to, with an intent to kill, is also hunting. You might not have finally hunted it when I killed it, but that also. So hunting is a very broad concept and broad definition. That has been put in the Wildlife Act. And the 1991 amendment obviously removed the terminology game, because game meant some removal of the material and it had some value kind of a thing in terms of economy also. So it was banned. And the exceptions, one exception was there, that the scheduled tribes of Andamans and Nicobar Islands, their hunting rights were recognized under this act. That is the only exception under this Wildlife Act. Otherwise, all hunting is banned all over India for all persons. So right to livelihood of Pardis got eclipsed, obviously. And it was put subordinate to the non-consumptive use of wildlife and natural resources by the society. Non-conjunctive use is you go and see the wildlife, enjoy the area, enjoy the ecosystems, services, and all those things. So they are non-conjunctive uses also wildlife. So this is the road on which the Indian Act, the Wildlife Act, traversed. And ultimately, you will see that with our own intervention as civilized society, we put in certain prescriptions, certain regulations, which favored the people who could go and hunt. And Britishers, or maybe even the later on the forest officers and the other government servants, they never got down from the jeep and hunted, obviously not. Or otherwise, they would come down, kill, and immediately come on the jeep again. So the basic purpose of the act to conserve the wildlife could not really help the Pardhis. Rather, the license Raj, the the rights of these people, they got really crushed, so to say. But along with this, what happened was that since the hunting was totally banned, now hunting is not an easy job. If you are not moving with a gun or a rifle, hunting an animal is not an easy job. It's very difficult. And these Pardhis used to hunt, imagine, without any guns and other things. So what they had in their knowledge was wild animal behavior, seasons of breeding. These were the knowledge base of the Pardhis. Then rearing of captured animals. Most of the Pardhis, you know, they would not kill the animal and bring home. They will capture the animal and bring home. It's because immediately they may not get the market. And therefore they would come, bring and capture the animal, keep at home, and then later on use it or sell it. So rearing of captured animals, how to do it is also an art. Then knowledge about wildlife habitats, ethics of hunting, trapping techniques, and trapped animal handling methods. These were the very special knowledge that the Pardhis had. And once you remove this hunting itself from the sphere of management, then obviously you will find that the technology vanishes because you are not using it. And that is happening with these indigenous knowledge of Pardhis also, because that is not being practiced at all. And therefore, nowadays you will find that if there is a tiger problem somewhere, first thing people say, oh, kill it. If there is a raid of blue bulls, Rohis we call it now in Maharashtra, the first thing people say, you just kill it. So capturing, keeping it, and later on releasing it as a system of management, that is suffering because the basic knowledge behind all this has suffered and is suffering. So imagine the kind of loss in terms of indigenous knowledge that is also happening because of all this. Another traditional competencies list that these people can be, I must say, credited with is the personal or group qualities of bravery. It's not easy to go and catch or kill a tiger when you are on foot, or any animal for that matter. Stealth, how to really dodge the smartness of the animal. Planning for hunting. Hunting is, you just can't go and hunt and come back, no. Even for birds, the kind of planning that they are doing, say using the various animals, gaikis, for example, they were using cows, deer, they were using deer for catching deer. Then grit, go into the forest and try to walk into the forest. Every corner you will feel that maybe here the tiger will jump on me or something will happen or a snake will appear. All this, how to know, how to understand, how to read the noise or of the jungle, all that has been their forte. Then perseverance, full day they would go and try to kill an animal or catch an animal, and they may not get anything. But no, they will not just leave and come and have a bottle of local beer. No. Perseverance is a very important characteristic. Then tact, knowledge of hunting tools. Hunting tools, making of hunting tools itself is not easy. And then handling it for with perfection. These are some very, very interesting knowledge spheres, which are all going because the relation between the Pardhis and the traditional basic resource base, that is cut. Then skill of attracting game by making false calls, birds, animals. They will make false calls and attract the birds, animals. These are very interesting things. You might have heard about the people from Belgaum who go to Delhi to catch monkeys from various ministries, as if there are not many monkeys otherwise also there. But the monkeys, the real jungle-wala monkeys, they have a big sort of dominance there. And there was a beautiful film also made on that, how to catch monkeys from Mantralaya or the various ministerial offices in Delhi. So these are the traditional competencies that the Pardhis had. They also had competency of hunting for medicine and food. So knowledge about this also is there. So you can see this all ban has a simultaneous effect on so many things, including a permanent loss of indigenous knowledge and skills. So let me trace the life of Pardhi now in short. You see, initially, wildlife was in plenty. Pardhi is where I showed to you that even till 2001, there were only 30,000 and odd. And the skills developed over time, very specific skills with reference to very specific resource base. And they became 11 types of Pardhis. So they diversified into occupational categories. During Mughal period, Hindu kings, etc., they supported these people, helped these people because of their own specialization. And through that, their specialization also became firm and concretized. During British Raj, there was a depletion of resource base because of all the kinds of interventions that we thought was good for us. The Pardhis could not operate the license Raj system. Then after 1972, with the VIPs and hunters and office government officials who hunted for pleasure, who were well connected and equipped with modern weapons, etc., etc., they also removed a lot of resource from the field, and the Pardhis were marginalized. And finally, in 1991, their livelihood itself got criminalized. So from a criminal kind of impression to another criminal kind of impression, today also they have been given some areas for cultivation in some places like Jalgaon and other places. But unfortunately, they are not used to that. It's not easy to go for agriculture also as a new sort of occupation. So they are moving here and there, and you might find on a red light chowk somewhere, somebody selling tidbits and all those things. Ask them and they will tell you, I'm a Pardhi. So this is the situation that we have brought these expert hunters. We should not say hunters is a bad name, but expert conservationists, in fact, to a situation where they have become ecologically, unfortunately, totally devastated. And it happened because the laws, our laws did not differentiate between hunting for livelihood and hunting for pleasure. Second thing, what was thing thought was that we just close the area and things will improve. That is the best management option. That is not the best management tool. There we have erred. Then even technologies, the knowledge base, indigenous knowledge, all those things took a back seat over time. So I have some suggestions to make. In the book also I have made suggestions that we should bring them back into resource management scene. In most of the PAs, protected areas, in the national parks, in handling the wild animals, in making the local people, villagers, and the government talk to each other on these issues. Today, you see, in last 20 years, you'll find a big difference in the sense that the villagers earlier, they used to treat these animals, the wild animals also, as their part of their life. Like here in the cities, somebody gets crushed by a car, we don't say that you remove all the cars from this area. Because it's a part of hazard. So they also had this thing as a part of their life, as a part of some hazard that, yes, someday a tiger will come and eat their, say, cow or bull. But over time, what has happened is that they have been made to feel that it is government's tiger. It is government's leopard. It is government's elephant. So they will say, Saab, apna, aap dekho kya karna. This is not our bothering. So this change in mindset has come in because people like Pardhis, they have stopped the talk between, they have stopped to intervene between the local people and the government, in fact, or the managers. So this is one very important thing that can come in. We create a resource base, document their methods, techniques, etc., provide compensation for the indigenous knowledge. We talk of IPR everywhere, intellectual property rights. Make them partners in management and then return the returns of the resources to the community, these communities, which I feel are very, very important from the point of conservation. Thank you.
Yes, I just wanted to mention, you know, sir mentioned about the Rohis. And I remember I come from Buldhana, district of Maharashtra. So here you have the tribe called Fase Pardhi. So which is the one of the most discriminated tribes among the Pardhis, I guess, right? So I remember my grandfather used to tell me that whenever in the, you know, in the villages, whenever the Rohis used to rush down to, you know, farmlands, and they were, you know, huge animals, they used to rush down in groups. And then they used to call Fase Pardhis to, you know, control them and this was the... this was the method earlier, but nowadays whenever such things happen, you know, either they are farms are destroyed by them, or you know, you just don't find the animals anymore. So these are the two conditions now. Second thing I want to ask you is, sir, you know, the Fase Pardhis here in Buldhana, whenever anything, you know, any robbery happens or any criminal act happens, the first, the first community to whom the, you know, the people, they say that there must be some Pardhis over here. So that is the reason why this happened. So is there, can we do anything to that? Like, they don't have any occupation because after the, amendment of 1991, the animal hunting was completely banned and they don't have any agricultural land for that matter. So what exactly would they do? Either they would do robbery or they would beg somewhere. So... are there any measures taken to improve their conditions?
Yeah, I would, as the first step, I would suggest that you know, even from within the Pardhis also, there are now people who are into different kinds of jobs, or they have shifted to different kinds of occupations. But most of the Pardhis who have the traditional knowledge of all these kinds of things, they should be associated with the protected areas. They should be associated with the forest department, the wildlife department, proactively. Because otherwise, normally what we think that, yes, if there is a hunting, yes, it's a fact also that there are cases where they have worked as the agents of some big poacher, etc. There are people like that. But why that happens is the issue to be asked here. If they are on our side, obviously they are the best informers. They will tell us on the first day that, yes, sir, this fellow had called me and he wants to come here to kill some animal, etc., etc. So we have to bring them to our side, and bringing them to our side is, as I told you, we must make them a partner in the management. We must give them a proper justice and the honor for their knowledge that they have. And not that, even in Amravati Road, you know, Amravati Paratwada Road, you will find there are hamlets. There also, that was the main complaint by the people, was this only. Sir, कहीं चोरी होती है ते काम कुठे पारधी आएगा तेनस धारा साहेब ते जस्तील. So this is the bias that governs the government officer's mind. That also is a very important thing to do. We must tell them that what their worth is and how we can utilize their knowledge, their skills, their competencies. So there has to be a very specific program like this build up.
Yes.
I just wanted to ask one more thing. The Pardhis have very special techniques of making liquors as well. So, some make it from the cashews or from the, whatever plants or medicinal plants, or let's say whatever plants are found in the forest. So can we use this to, improve their condition or create an sort of industry through this?
You see, there was a plan about 10 years back to use mahua. Mahua is a flower, उसका बहुत बढ़िया ड्रिंक बनता है लोकली दे मेक इट बट एज अ गवर्नमेंट स्पॉन्सर्ड प्रोग्राम इट वाज शॉट डाउन बेसिकली दे सेड दैट नो फ्रॉम गवर्नमेंट साइड वी शुड नॉट प्रमोट मेकिंग दारू फ्रॉम महुआ बिकॉज अदरवाइज महुआ हैज सो मेनी अदर यूजेस आल्सो इफ यू गो टू द ट्राइबल कम्युनिटीज यू सी दे ईट महुआ ड्यूरिंग द टाइम व्हेन दे डोंट हैव much of food, or during this up to here the connectivities have gone up, but when the roads were cut and there was floods, etc., that time people used to survive on these mahua and other things only. You see, you will never find a case where a tribal fellow living inside the forest, deep inside the forest, has committed suicide. No, agriculturists have. And that is because their local knowledge about the food from the forest, the how to survive on the forestry species, all those things, it's a, great amount of knowledge that is not being really utilized by us. So there are so many other things. From mahua itself, nowadays, they are making mahua candy, mahua ka ek syrup, all those things, they are being sold now. From Garchiruli area, from Gondia area, there are SHGs, self-help groups. They are doing it. So it has to be gradually brought into a proper marketing forum. Aajkal kya dabbe ka shakal se log saman khareedte hain. So, but they have the material ka quality. So this we have to gradually bring there also, that we should have a marketing linkage or maybe interface. So a very concerted effort on this front is very much required, and I appreciate your inputs on this. Thank you.
So just a follow up on this. when they are using all these products with mahua, could a GI patent help in help the community? Because I have seen the mahua alcohol which is being consumed by urbanists, and it was an urban guy, entrepreneur, who was doing it. So there was no GI patent which perhaps could have prevented him from doing it, and could have promoted the local Pardhi people into having a livelihood.
True, I agree with you. In fact, intellectual property rights ka bahut bada, there is a new act that has come in Forest Rights Act. There is a Forest Rights Act, although uska misuse bhi bahut hua hai bahut jagah pe. But some of the very bright parts of the Forest Rights Act is the intellectual property rights being recognized in favor of the tribals. So that has to come forward. Abhi kya, unfortunately kya ho gaya ki everybody is thinking Forest Rights Act means जमीन दे दो खेती करेगा. अरे खेती करके तो बेचारा अच्छे जगह में जहां है ना वहां पे सुसाइड कर रहा है लोग. So and with such poor area, with such tough area, बहुत बढ़िया area होता है ना तो British उसको already उसको agriculture में convert किया होता. So whatever area that is being given to them is hardly anything for their life, the tribals. These things that we are talking about, or you have just now said, intellectual property ka, even Biodiversity Act also provides for lot of returns to the community because of conserving that area for a particular medicinal plant resource. If that is operationalized properly, that will create wonders for these people. You know,
Arvind ji, namaste. Thank you so much for the talk. Unfortunately, like most Indians, I learned about Pardhi people when I was planning a trip to Panna National Park, and I got to know about this program, which is, I believe, Walk with the Pardhi or the Day with the Pardhi, something like this. And got to know that, you know, with them you can actually spend a day, get to know the flora, the fauna, about the place. So there are some initiatives which are in place. But then if I look at the government, I think they have just given them an ST or an OBC category and done with it. So are there more, because more than just giving them ST, ST or an OBC category, it is more about integrating them with the society where they face maximum issue. So what do you think would be the, is that the society is supposed to do? So that would be question number one. Two, while I was reading about Pardhi, I also, as when you learn about, when you're reading about a tribe, you often land at the Joshua Project page. And you realize that they have done a good research on them to say that, okay, these are the people who, while they practice, you know, Hindu dharma, they don't know that it is Hindu dharma. So it's very easy to mislead these people. So would you have an idea about any work done by the organization to actually educate these people so that they don't fall into the trap of projects like Joshua Project?
Actually, Pardhis, the work on the Pardhis from that particular point of view, I have not really come across. Even unfortunately, most of the studies that are there, or most of the exposure that you have about Pardhis, it comes from the newspaper reports, and which would newspaper would catch those elements which make news, and therefore they would most of the times blame the Pardhis, or okay, this has happened and that has happened. But for doing this to bring in them into the fold of so-called developed world, which I many times think that they are in a better situation. Not talking about the economic part of it, but life-wise, you know. The only thing that the society can do is to nudge the government. Ultimately, about the tribals, there is a specific tribal development department. I'll give you a bit of history about this. About 40, 50 years back, all these villages where you have tribals today, they were all forest villages. And that time the forest department and the revenue department, they used to take care of all the needs of these people. Even medicine, even hospitals, etc., were organized by the forest department. People thought that forest department is trying to hegemonize everything and become the power center, etc., etc. But the fact is that if you don't relate these tribes to the resource base on which they are dependent, they can never be developed. Today, the tribal department's funding is proportionate to the percentage of population it has in a state as per act. So in Maharashtra, you have 11%, approximately 11% of Maharashtra's total budget dedicated to these tribal people. And what is done by that is some beneficiary scheme will be there where they'll be provided with some chulas or some pipe line or something which really does not connect them to their life that they have with nature, with the resource base around them. If you are on the sea coast, you will obviously like to train people in fishing, make them fishermen, so that they have a connect with the resource base and develop. Here we have truncated the relation between the forest and wildlife and the tribes by truncating the departments. We created a tribal dependent department. So they say that this is my constituency. Forest department says conservation minus men minus tribals is my constituency, which can and will never work. Now, the problem of the tribal is not the problem of the tribal. It is the problem of coordination between forest department and tribal department. It is the problem of coordination between tribal, forest and revenue department. So by creating so many departments, you know, for handling the same person who has been a very simple person and related to the area nearby in terms of resource management, we have created problems for them. And that is the real bottleneck. From that point of view, I think the society should, number one, seek the government to have integrated programs wherein the relation between the forest, wildlife and tribals, that is highlighted and specified for the sustenance of both, not only the tribals but also the forest and the wildlife. This is the need of the hour. Only then these people will develop. Otherwise, giving them 1,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees a year or month, it's not going to really work because it's not sustainable. It's doling. So the society should come up with this kind of a thing, because government will on its own will not come out with this kind of a situation, because every department thinks ki bhai hum to raja hai. And that is unfortunate, but a real fact. So I think this society should create awareness on these lines.
So there was this Forest Rights Act that was passed in 2006. So what has it had any beneficial impact on this community or any other forest living community? And secondly, regarding the liquor, why is it that the government objects to Mahua liquor when it is anyway selling liquor through authorized vends and so on, Indian made foreign liquor and so on? These are my two questions.
The first question regarding Forest Rights Act. You see, Forest Rights Act came with a very good intention, and it was basically recognition of forest rights on the forest land. During implementation, what has happened that those people, and you will be happy to know that the act defined the beneficiaries of this act very specifically, and they are forest dwelling scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers. These are the two categories of people. They are supposed to be benefited, not a third person at all. Initially, it was started with a very good intention, implemented also. But later on, what happened, the people who could manage the whole scenario, they started coming in, getting the rights illegally. I can definitely vouch for it, illegally, because I have seen the papers. Unfortunately, I handled the Forest Conservation Act implementation in the state of Maharashtra as Commissioner Tribal Research and Training Institute. We instituted a satellite image-based verification system to ensure that only those people who have had their self-cultivation area before 2005, as per the condition of the Act, verify it and then give it. That satellite system has been removed from the operation by the government. Rather, the government of India, by amending the rule, has said that the satellite, that the evidence based on satellite image will be at best a supportive evidence and not an independent evidence to say that somebody was or was not a real claimant, true claimant under this Act. So once you allow this kind of a other people, whether any act, in any act, if you allow such people to creep in, the real beneficiaries of the people of the Act, they get affected. And by that process, lot of areas have been encroached. It's a fact. And with that kind of encroachment, what is ultimately happening is, it is again going to reduce the resource base of the people who are dependent on that, including the Pardhis. So that is a very big kind of a impact. And therefore, first thing I will say, that Forest Right Act should be implemented sincerely and honestly by the government. If that is done, it would have done, if that was done, it would have been a great sort of effect, had a great effect on the on these tribals. One. Second thing is, even one in community rights, there have been problems where that those are being usurped by people who are not really eligible. So there are problems in Forest Rights Act, and therefore such people are not really going to get the benefit. As regards Mahua, you see, government is not against the Mahua liquor as such. There are people who are brewing in the villages and they are drinking. I was talking about the Mahua liquor being promoted by the government as a project. That yes, we will have a Mahua liquor making sort of industry or something of that sort. That was shut down at that time.